That means that if you do one, then you need not do the other. If the homa is performed by yava, I guess, then you need not perform the homa with vrihi. Yatha ekaiko, ekaineva kritarthatvat nanutishthet tataha param. If you get the result by doing one, you need not do the other one. The idea is that suppose on this Makar Sankranti yesterday, you can give dhanam, you can give tilam, sesame, you can give wheat, you can give this kind of things. So by giving any one of them, the same result is produced, same punya phala is produced, and you need not give all of them. Just give one and you get the punya phala that you want. Similarly, by performing one karma, if mukti comes, then you need not perform other karma. Then other karmas become redundant. When the Vedas are enjoining so many karmas, and if any one of them can become the cause of mukti, then others become redundant. So, ekeneva kritarthatvat nam pishtet tatha param. Nacha virishyadiva vikalpena arthavatvam. Moksha-muddhishya karmasu tadasrutehe agatyaja tadashraya iti bhavaha. Moksha-muddhishya karmasu tadasrutehe. In fact, we do not find that a karma is enjoined for moksha. You don't find that kind of statement anywhere. So agatyaja tadashraya. Therefore, this agatya means since there is no other choice or no other alternative, this kind of ashraya, since we do not find a given karma as a means of moksha specifically stated, therefore we are presenting this, I think, considering the alternatives, whether one karma alone will give or other karmas are required. Prayoge dakshinayam cha samanoyam parikramaha atha sambhuya sarvani muktim karvani kurvate aik karmyam dhruvam prapad sarvesham vikarmanam dashadvat phalaikatvat tachanishtam prasajjade. In short, one karma cannot be the cause of mukti, because which karma is that? We do not find Shruti saying that a given karma gives us to moksha. Therefore, which karma will it be? If one karma alone becomes the cause of moksha, then what's the role of the other karmas? They will become redundant. So your position that just one karma can give us to mukti cannot be. Then you will say that all the karmas will give rise to mukti. So that is the position that is next taken. Sakrut prayogat eka dakshinayam cha mukti di pakshayoho uktam dosham ati disade. So sakrut prayogat. In that karma also, one karma also should perform once or many times or lifetime. Sakrut prayogat. Or eka dakshinayam. Should you give one cow or many cows or all the cows, then what is applicable to one karma also is applicable to performing karma once or with one dakshina. So ati deshadi, same rule also is extended here. Prayoge dakshinayam cha samanoyam parikramaha. In short, whether one karma is performed once or many times or lifetime, same parikrama means the same redundance of other karmas will be there. Or if one cow alone is to be given, once or many times or lifetime, then also other cows, etc. will become, so dakshinas of more cows will become redundant. If dakshina of one cow can give rise to moksha, then we are also told in other karmas that dakshinas of many of the cows are given, they also become redundant. So that is atidesha. Nitatra prayogantaram dakshinantaram va sarthakam ityartha. Then performing ignihutra even second time will have no purpose to serve, or giving dakshina of other cow also will not serve the purpose. Okay. Now comes another kalpa. Kalpantra manudya dushayari. Adha sambhuya sarvani karmani muktim, sarvani muktim karmani kurvate. Asa, now that one karma can give rise to mukti, that doesn't make sense. That is shown. Then you might say that all the karmas performed give rise to mukti. That is impossible, of course, that will be shown. But second alternative is all the karmas become the means of mukti. Atha sambhuya sarvani karmani. Sambhuya means together. Sarvani muktim karmani ka sarvani karmani muktim karmade. That is the position. That all the karmas in combination, they give rise to mukti then. There is a technical aikakarmyam dhrum prapata. Then you cannot call them sarva karma. Then all they become one karma, you see. The thing is, if all the karmas will perform to give rise to mukti, then why do you call it all karma? It becomes one karma. So, actually, the Shruti of the Vedas enjoin so many rituals. If any one ritual gives rise to moksha, then other rituals are all redundant. Therefore, all so many rituals would not have been enjoined. Since so many rituals are enjoined, and according to you, karma is a cause of, means of moksha, then that means all the rituals must be performed to get moksha. But if one person has to perform all the rituals, then they become as good as one karma, then the distinction of different karmas are not there, because all the karmas are to be performed together. It's called aika karmyam. Then they fall in the category of one karma alone. Dhrum prapat sarveshanavi karmanam. All the karmas, since they are to be performed together, they will as good as become one karma. Why is it so? Darshadvat phalaikatvat. That's interesting. Why do you call this one karma? Because they give rest to one phala. So, if, see, darshadivat, here I have another footnote here, just to, ekasvarga phalakanam shinnamapi darshadiyaganam ekarmatvam yatha. Whatever there are, this darsha, purnamasa, etc., all of these, there are six yagas are there, agnihotra, all of these six yagas should be performed by a person, then alone this svarga can come. The idea is that if you are Agnihotri, then Agnihotra is to be done every day. But at the same time, when there is Purnima, then this Purnamasa karma also must be performed. When the Ramavasa, then Darsha karma also must be performed. And then other things are also there. What is Chaturmasyam? Every Chaturmasa you must perform the karma. Then what is Agrayanam? Again, in the beginning of the spring season also some karma must be performed. So, all these karmas are to be performed, Vaishwadeva also must be performed. So, all of these are also enjoined. Just as when you are to do these Satyanarayana pujas and other angas also must be there. That Varuna puja also must be done and Ganesha puja also must be done and things like that. So, they do not count as separate karmas. All of them count as one because the result of all of them is one in combination. Similarly also is Darsha, Purnamasa and whatever it is. All of the six yagas do not count as six different yagas. They all count as one because all of them in combination give rise to one phala, namely svarga. Next is, so many karmas you need to perform. For example, we are going to yatra, you know, so many karmas you need to perform. You pack your bag, luggage also, and go to the railway station also, and travel in the railway also, and then travel in the bus also, and walk also 1 mile, and then go to the temple and have darshan. All of these give rise to one phala and darshanam, you know. And therefore, all of them is called one karma, not different karma. So many karmas are performed to have darshan, but the end result of all the karma is what? One darshanam. Therefore, actually it is called one yatra. Although yatra involves six different things, you know, it is called one. So, idea is that when several karmas in combination give rise to one phala, they are not called several karmas, they are called one karma. One Satyanarayana puja, although it may involve several karmas, preparing shira, etc., so many things may be done, buying flowers and decoration and all kinds of things are done, and still it is called one puja, because the phala is one. So, eka phalakatva, this is the phalikatva. So, if one phala is there, just as darsha, purnamasa, all of these yagas are maybe six, and still they are called one karma because all of them give rise to one phala. And similarly also, if according to you, if all the karmas give rise to moksha, then moksha being one phala, therefore all the karmas fall in the category of one karma. Therefore it is aika karmyam dhrum prapata sarveshavi karmanam, then all the karmas actually attain the state of becoming one karma. Darshadivat phalekatvat. Like darsha, purnamasa, etc., give rise to one phala, all of these give rise to one phala in moksha, therefore, they fall in the category of aika karma. Aika karma means one karma. So what's wrong with that? Tacha anishtam prasajyade, and that is undesirable. Dushtandastu Prageva Vivrutaha. Dushtanda is that Darshapurnamasam. Prag means what? In that discussion it may have come. When earlier the discussion may have taken place. Then next, Aik Karmiye Kya Kahanehi. Alright. Suppose all the rituals are there, they are all called one karma. Kahani, what's wrong with them? Tachya anishtam prasajjade, that is undesirable. What's undesirable? Then the Tikakar explains. Nahi brihaspati sava rajasuyadinam bhinnadhikarinam aikakarmyam iti bhavaha. Do you know that the Vedas enjoin so many rituals for so many people? Brihaspati sava is a yaga that is enjoined for brahmana. Other fellows are not qualified to do that. Rajasuya is a yaga that is enjoined for the kshatriya. Other fellows are not qualified to do that. Bhinna adhikarinam aikakarmyam. If you have to perform all this karma, how can you do that? No one fellow is even qualified to do. Only brahmana can do a given thing, kshatriyas will do some other thing, vaishya also has his own karmas. And therefore, how can you say that all the karmas are one? In that case, what will happen is, all the karmas are, everybody is adhikari for every karma. Then alone this is possible. This is possible only when everybody is adhikari for every karma. And that is not the case. Till they say, no, brahmana should not perform rajasva yaga. Kshatriya should not perform brihaspati sava. And so, bhinna adhikarinam aikarmyam vibhavaha. And then other things are also there. So the Aika Karmam is not there. Vishuti, in fact, wants that all the karmas are different. They are not one karma. And therefore the adhikaris are different, even the results are also different. Then the Tika continues, Asakridva Yavajivam va prayogad bahunam va gavadinam sarvasyava dakshinaya moksha na setsati ekasev asakrud. Yavad jivam va prayoga mukti chet karmandara prayoga vayatya. Other alternatives are also dismissed like this. Asakrudva, meaning several times you perform the same karma. Yavad jivam va, the same karma is performed the whole lifetime. Prayogat bahunam va gavadinam, or you give one cow or many cows. Sarvasyava dakshinayam, or all the cows are given up. Mokshaha na setsadi. Then we say that then also moksha cannot be accomplished. Why? Eka seva asakrita yavat jivam va prayoge muktischet. If one karma alone performing several times or a lifetime can give rise to mukti, then what's the role of other karmas? Even one person is supposed to perform many karmas, and so other karmas become redundant. Karmandara prayoga vayatyat. Sarva karma prayogastu ekasya asakyaha. If you say that all the karmas give rise to mukti, no one person can perform all of them. Why? Number one, that no one person is adhikari for all the karmas. And even if I am adhikari, how can I perform rajasuya and brihaspati sava and everything else? Is asakyam. Nacha bahunam sarivasyava dakshana moksha hetu. Or that, if you give many cows or all the cows, that can give rise to moksha. There is no manam, meaning no pramana, no statement says that giving many cows or all the cows will bring what moksha. Then says, Nacha hiranyada amratattvam bhajande iti shruti manam. Says, wait a minute, there is a shruti statement. It says, hiranyada amratattvam bhajande. So one who gives gold in gift, he attains amratattvam, immortality. So similarly also, one giving rise to all the cows may go become immortal, why not? He says that statement is not to be taken literally. Dana prashamsa paratvar. To say that hiranyada amrutattvam bhajande. Hiranyada means what? Hiranyam dadati. One gives to hiranya, he gives hiranya, he gains immortality. That should not be taken literally. Dana prashamsa paratvar. That statement is to extol dana. Anyatha nisheda shruti virodhat. Otherwise, if by giving this gold, for giving cows you can get moksha. Then nisheda shruti is what? Nanyah pantha vidyate yanaya. So without knowledge one cannot gain the moksha. All those statements also will become redundant. Iti cha artha. All of this also should be understood, that all the pakshas are also, they stand dismissed in this manner. Anyadhi mukti phala. This topic is concluding slowly. Anyadhi mukti phala taha kamyanam shruyate phalam tesha mukti phalatvam tu na shruyate na vichanyataha. Then kamyirva, nityairva, kamyakarma, nityakarma. So that alternative also was there. That is brought up here. Kamyirva iti paksham pratyaham. If you say that kamya karma gives us to moksha, that is answered here. Anyadhi mukti phalataha kamyanam shruyate phalam. You know very well that kamya karma are said to give rise to phala other than moksha. Kamya karma means the karma performed with a desire. And naturally, kamya karma can give rise to swarga and putra and all kinds of things, but no kamya karma is said to give rise to mukti. Anyadhi mukti phalataha kamyanam shruyate phalam. Kamyanam karmanam mukti phala anyadhi phalam shruyate. So we find that other phala than mukti, phala other than mukti is what we hear. Next, what is enjoined by Shruti or said by the Shruti? Tesham mukti phalatvam tu na shrutehe. Nowhere it is said in the Shruti that kamya karma give rise to moksha. Napich anyatah. Okay, so going the tika. Kamyanam svargadi phalatve shrute api moksha phalatvam na virudhyate dhadhyadehe nityarthe kamyarthe cha shravanadi ashankyaah. Somebody says, kamyanam svargadi phalatve shrute api moksha phalatvam na virudhyate. All right, kamya karma, agnihotra also can be kamya karma. So suppose that gives rise to svarga, but agnihotra can also give rise to moksha. Like, dadhyadina dadhyadehe nityarthe kamyarthe cha shravanat. So dadhi, this name is yaga. So when you perform the yaga, the point is that if you perform a karma with a desire, the desire will fulfill. If you perform the karma without a desire, then it will give rise to antahakarana shuddhi. So one karma can give rise to different results. So also your kamya karma can give rise to moksha, why not? Therefore it is tesham mukta phalatvam tu na shrutehe. But nowhere in the Shruti it is said that kamya karma can give rise to moksha. Shruti says that dadhi can give rise to different results, and therefore we can accept that a given yaga can give rise to different results if performed differently. There are other options are there. But nowhere do we find that kamya karma is said to give rise to moksha. Ashrutamapi smrutehe nyayadva ishyatam. Why not? Because the Smriti says, or because reasoning says, why not? Even though Smriti does not say, why can't you say that kamya karma can give rise to moksha? Iti ashankya napi cha anyatah. Nowhere in the Smriti do we find, nor in Nyaya we find that the kamya karma can give rise to moksha. Okay, I think we'll continue tomorrow with this. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Veda Vibhagine Vyoma Vatyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.
Is
with reference to the means for moksha, in the Purvapaksha, that either karma or the samuchaya, the combination of karma with jnanam, where jnanam would mean either upasana or brahma vidya, so that samuchaya also cannot be the means for moksha. This is the point that is being made. An important point was how karma is a product of ignorance, and therefore it is not in keeping with the nature of vastu. Vastu ananusarityat. Whereas jnanam can be technically said to be product of ignorance, but still it is vastu anusari. Product of ignorance is a state of mind, and mind is a product of ignorance. In that sense, one may say, even jnanam, that vritti, aham brahmasmi, also is a product of ignorance. So it can be said, inasmuch as all the vyavahar, all the transaction is at the vyavaharic level, and therefore everything, even the teacher and the taught and the teaching, all of that is the vyavahara, therefore you can say it is all in the realm of ignorance. It can be said. However, still that jnanam is, it is that which destroys ignorance, because jnanam is vastu anusari. Knowledge is in keeping with the vastu, nature of vastu, and not ignorance. So ignorance or karma which is product of ignorance are not in keeping with nature of vastu. Like this sarpajnanam. So sarpajnanam also is jnanam. But that cannot dispel the ignorance of rope, because that sarpajnanam itself is a product of ignorance. We call it jnanam, all right. So this mithyajnanam, ajnanam, mithyajnanam, samshayajnanam, all of these are jnanam sort of. They are all illumined by Chaitanyam, the consciousness, as much as the Vrittiham Brahmasmi is illumined by Chaitanyam. And still, those are vastu ananusari and not vastu anusari. So this is called upadhi. This is what actually makes karma incapable of dispelling ignorance, because it is not vastu anusari. He said, then another point that was made, so having dealt with this, then the Granthakara or the Vartikara here addresses another issue. It's all right, if you say that karma is a means of moksha, then we ask you this, is it one karma that is a means of moksha, or several karmas that are means of moksha, or all the karmas are means of moksha? Again, one karma performed once, or several times, or lifetime, or several karma and all the karmas performed once and several times and lifetime. And then also when it comes to dakshina, because in dakshina also the vikalpas are there, dakshina of the nature of being one cow or many cows or all the cows. So what do you consider as a means of moksha? And then again when it comes to the combination, samuchya of jnana and karma, karma jnana means brahma vidya here, then samapradhanatvam, so whether jnana and karma enjoy the equal predominance, equal importance, or karma is important, jnana is subordinate, or jnanam is important, karma is subordinate. So many pakshas or suppositions or vikalpas are given for the consideration of whether or not it can become the means of moksha. Then the point was, if just one karma is the means of moksha, if according to you, Shruti enjoins karma as the means of moksha, and just one, any one karma is the means of moksha, then what is the need for the Shruti to enjoin so many karmas? Shruti would not have enjoined so many kinds of rituals had one ritual been a means of moksha. The fact that Shruti enjoins so many variety of rituals means that one karma cannot be means of moksha, otherwise other karmas will become redundant. And similarly, performing karma once were the means of moksha, then why do they ask us to perform karma lifetime? And so performance again also would be redundant. And the same argument applies to the one giving dakshina of one cow or many cows and all the cows. So if giving one dakshina of one cow is enough, then why more than one, so several times, or lifetime, or more than one cow and so forth. And thus it was shown how all of that, and another important point was, and that is being discussed, is the second is, suppose all the karmas become the means of moksha. Then, if all the karmas together become means of moksha, then all the karmas are one phala, namely moksha. The rule is that which gives us to one phala should be considered as one karma. Even though several rituals or several karmas may be involved, Still, as long as they give rest to one phala, the discussion was like the Swarga. So Darsha, Purnamasa, etc., all of these, which are six different kinds of yagas, all of them in combination give rest to one phala, namely Swarga, then they are not considered as different yagas, they are all considered as one yaga. So if you say that all the karmas together give rise to the result called moksha, then they will be considered as one karma and not many karmas. So let it be so. Tachya anishtam. And that's not right. Why? Because what a brahmana can do like Brihaspati Sava, a kshatriya cannot perform, and Rajasu Yajna, a kshatriya can perform, a brahmana cannot perform. And therefore, number one, it is not possible for a person to perform all the karmas because one is not qualified to do that. And even if one were qualified, then also it is not possible to perform them all. It's not, you know, not within the scope of one to do them all. And therefore, all of these cannot become one karma. Other, because different adhikaris are there. Now if you say that all the karmas together give rise to one phala, then it should be all branded as one karma, which is not possible because different adhikaris are there, and everyone is not qualified to perform all the karmas. Now on page 742, again whether kamya karma can become means of moksha. Now, in the first line, anyadhya mukti phalataha kamya naam shuvade phalam. We very well know that kamya karma, meaning the actions performed or desire prompted actions, are known to produce different kinds of results, like swarga, putra, etc. So anyadhya mukti phalataha, nowhere do we see in the Shruti that a kamya karma results in the moksha. We never hear that. Kamyanam shruvate phalam, tesham mukta phalatvam tu shrutir napena chanyataha. Neither in the Shruti nor in Smriti do we hear that the kamya karma of any kind can give rise to moksha, nor is it reasonable also, nor is it in keeping the reason that kamya karma, meaning an action performed to fulfill a specific desire, can give rise to moksha, is not reasonable also. Sarvam chapya pramanam syad. Now we are continuing there in the on the page 742 with the fourth line of the Vartika. Sarvam chapya pramanam syad yaduktam bheda lakshanam muktim sarvani karmani yadi sambhuya kurvate. Same point. If, as you say, all the karmas together bring about moksha, then other technical difficulties are there. So this is as bheda lakshanam. Sarvam chabi apramanam syad yad yuktam bheda lakshanam. In the Purva Mimamsa, it is determined that the karmas are all different. They are not one karma, karmas are all different. And what is that creates or that difference? How do we determine that one karma is different from another karma? So many criteria are given there. See, look at the tika. Yadiva nitya hidi paksham agre dushayishyavi. So whether nitya karma can become means of moksha or not, that will be seen later on. We'll show you where the defect of thinking is involved there. Sampradi. Sarvaiva ityadi paksha chatushtam nirashaste. Sarvaiva. So paksha chatushtam. See, if you go back on the previous page, Vartika 45. Kamyevaya divanityahi sarvaiva muktihi shade sravutairvaya divasmartahi yadivavaya karma bhi. So sarva karma, all sravuta karma, all smart karma, or all sravuta and smart karma. That paksha is taken, sarva karma. So sarvaiva ityadi paksha tirushtam nirashaste sarvam cha. Asya arsaham. Nityanam, kamyanam, shrautanam, smartanam, sarveshanam va karmanam moksha phalatve. You say that all the nitya karmas, just nitya karmas together give moksha, or all kamya karma give moksha, or shrauta karma give moksha, or smarta karma give moksha, all of them. These four pakshas are there. All the nitya karmas, or all the kamya karmas, or all the shrauta karmas, or all the smarta karmas. Sarvesham, all of them together, let us say. Suppose you say that, take any paksha. Moksha phalate, prachyam imamsayam, sabdantara abhyasat prakriya namadheyad bhedakam yaduktam sarvam tadapramanam syat. So the Purva Mimamsa doesn't determine that all of these actually indicate that the karmas are different. Shabdantara is, shabdas are different, then karma is different. Shabdantara. Yajeta, dadhyada, then juhuyad. So, this is how they say, you know. Yajeta, one should perform yaga in this manner, or dadhyad should give this, or juhuyad should offer this. So all these different shabdas are used. That means that each refers to different karma, and not that they all refer to same karma. So that's how in the Purva Mimamsa they want to determine whether the karmas from one group or they are different from each other. So one criterion to determine that the karmas are different from one another is that they use the shabda prayoga as different, the dhyat, jihuyat, yajeta, like that, you know. So that means the karmas are different. Bhinna dhatvarthakam bhinnam, because every dhatu has a different meaning. Dadyat means giving. So one should give, one should offer, one should sacrifice. That means all these words are different, meaning different. Therefore, the actions that are karma that are involved with reference to dhatu are also different. Then abhyasa samidho yajati, tanuna padam yajati, abhyasa. So when you find even yajati is one, now you'll say that the yajati is one, therefore all the karma are saying yajati are one, say no. Samidho yajati, tanuna padam yajati. Then in one case he offers samid, in other case tanuna padam, even though abhyasa is there, still the karmas are different, because what is being offered is different. Prakriya, meaning in different prakranas are there, so Agnihotra prakrana, this prakrana. So if the karmas are mentioned in those prakranas, then also they are different. Namadheya, different namas are there. Jyotihi, then what is it? Earth, Vishwa Jyotihi. So this Vishwa Jyotihi, then like this. So one karma is called Jyoti, other is called Vishwa Jyoti. Different names are there. Then also karmas are different. Jyotishtuma is one karma, Agnihotra is another karma. So if the names of the karma are different, then we know that different karmas. Or we involve different dravya, then also we know there are different karmas. Or the method of performance is different, then also we know there are different karmas. That means the Purva Mimamsa has established that these karmas are different from one another. Now if you say that all the karmas together produce moksha, then another rule is that if karmas produce one phala, phalaikatva, then the karma is considered as one. And thus, if all the karmas produce moksha, then all of them should be considered as one. Whereas Purva Mimamsa says all the karmas are different from one another, therefore, all that is established in the Purva Mimamsa would be wrong or redundant, apramanam, if you say that all the karmas give rise to one phala, namely moksha. Idea is that these karmas cannot have one phala, otherwise they would not have been different. Fact that they are different means that they give rise to different phala, and that means that moksha cannot be that phala. So shabdantara abhyasa prakriya namadhyadi bhedakam yaduktam saram tat apramanam. So all of that they have arrived at, all of that will become apramanam. Why? Phalaikatve karmaveda anupattehe. Phalaikatve. Because when the phala is one, then the karmas cannot be different. If karmas are different, phalas are also different. If phalas are different, then moksha cannot be the one phala, so many different phalas are there. So you cannot say that all the karmas in combination give rise to phala called moksha. Ataha moksha phalatve sarva karmanam aika karmyad bheda lakshana virodhasya. Therefore, if moksha is the phala, all the karmas would be grouped as one, which would be wrong, and which would be different from the conclusion they arrived at in the Purva Mimamsa. Therefore also, so different reasons have been given how all the karmas together cannot be a means of moksha, because as you said, one cannot perform them all. And number two, they will all be called one karma, which also will contradict the decisions or the conclusions arrived in the Purva Mimamsa. Then the Vatve continues, sadhya sadhana buddhirnaha vachanat paralaukiki nacha shravusham shruter vakyat karma moksha phalam kvachita. Then the Tika says, ekaikam karma mokshadam ityadi sarvapakshesu sadharanam doshamaha. That one single karma is a means of moksha. whether performed once, several times, lifetime, so forth and so on. All the pakshada sadhana dosha. What is it? Sadhya sadhana buddhi naha means for us. Sadhya sadhana buddhi vachanat paralaukigi. Paralaukigi sadhya sadhana buddhi. This point came earlier already. That when you want to determine what is the sadhana means for attainment of paralaukika sadhya. Paralaukika sadhya means a sadhya or end which is beyond our perception or beyond the range of our own knowledge. If you want to determine, so how do you get sun? Or how do you get wealth? How do you get svarga? How do you get rains, let us say, you know? There is no way that we can determine with the knowledge or understanding available to us as to how to bring about rain or how to go to svarga and so forth. Therefore, how do we determine the means for attainment of those ends? So how to get crops, I know. So when I sow the seeds and till the land and so forth, then I know that we can get the crops, all right. So I don't require Vedas to determine or to advise me what I should do in order to get my wheat and rice and so forth. Or I know that, so these are all called drashtafalas. So when I eat food, then my hunger is appeased. There also I do not require scriptures to advise me because this is something that we can determine. So there are many things that we can determine ourselves in our life as to what should be the sadhana or means to attain various ends. But there are many ends which are paralaukika, meaning which are not within the range of our experience. And therefore, there is no way that we can determine what is sadhana or means of attainment of those ends. That is where we require Vedas or the scriptures. Sometimes we know the means, but we do not know the end. Like Agnihotra, Darsha Purnamasa, etc. We know how to perform it. But you don't know what the end is. Then the Vedas tell you what the end will be. So, if the end also is not known, the means Veda can tell us. If the means are known, the Vedas will tell us the end. Or sometimes means and end both are not known. Then also we will require the scriptures. So this idea is that either the means or the end or both are paralaukika. Then we require the Vedas to tell us, you know, the relationship between them. We cannot determine that relationship. Sadhya sadhana buddhinah vachanat paralaukiki. That means that we cannot decide what the result of a given karma will be. Only Vedas can tell us that. If this is so, then nata shravasham shruter vakyat karma moksha phalam kvajit. Then that moksha also is paralaukika kind. And therefore, what should be the means of moksha? We do not find anywhere in the Shruti that karma produces moksha. Nowhere it is said. Moksha kamo yajeta. We don't find that. Svarga kamo yajeta, putra kamo yajeta, grama kamo yajeta. So how to get a grama? How to get a putra? How to get svarga? For that, all the yagas are there. But moksha kamo yajeta, we never find that. And so, nati asravusham shruter vakyat karma moksha phalam kvachit. So not a single karma. Nowhere we find the Shruti that a given karma is prescribed or enjoined as a means of moksha. Now one karma or all karmas, etc., they cannot become means of moksha. This is sarvapakshesu sadharanam dosha. This is sadharana, the dosha that is common to all that those options. Then continues, natatra dakshinayanti vidyayeva tadapyade vedahamiti mantrasya jnanan margantarapanut. Then says man abhavam smaraitva. So first Granthakara says that there is no pramanam which says that a given karma is a means of moksha. Okay, man abhavam smaraitva. So keval karmana moksha itutve man virodham. Not only that, there is no statement of Shruti which says that one cannot attain moksha by karma, but there are several statements which say that karma cannot give rise to moksha. So we don't find a single statement saying that a given karma is a means of moksha, but we find several statements where it is said that the karma cannot be means of moksha. So mana abhava is there and mana virodha is there. There is no manam and there is mana virodha. Mana virodha is pramana virodha. Na tatta dakshinaha yanti. Saptamya prasamayache kaivalyam paramrshade na tatra dakshinahayanti. Meaning tatra means moksha. As far as moksha is concerned, dakshinaha. What is dakshinaha? Dakshinaha okay, that we are not told here. But then, dakshinana margarhaha. Dakshina means the fellows who are only fit for going to dakshinayana. So the thing is, that is uttarayana marga, dakshinayana marga. So it is said, dakshinayana marga is leading to pitruloka. Karmana pitrulokaha, vidya devalokaha. So by karma one attains pitruloka. Pitruloka is what you can reach by dakshinayana, by the southern solstice. And that means it is a path of karma. So those who perform merely rituals and not perform upasanas, so they attain pitruloka by the dakshinayana, means the southern solstice. So natatra dakshinahayanti, when it is said, that as far as moksha is concerned, the dakshinas meaning those who are fit to travel on dakshinayana, they cannot reach moksha, meaning that the people who are merely performing karma cannot reach moksha. Meaning thereby that karma is not a means of moksha. This is the mana virodha. Then, vidyaya eva tadapyade. This is the prasama vibhakti. That is also kaivalyam. Vidyaya eva kaivalyam apyade. One can attain kaivalya or moksha only by vidya or brahma vidya. The evakara. Vidyaya eva. Evakara says that not by anything other than vidya. So that excludes everything other than vidya. That means karma cannot attain moksha. Vidahamiti mantrascha. Then the Tikakara says, mantayadu tamevam vidvanadisheshaha anusandheyaha. So vidahametam purusham mahantam adityavarnam tamasaf prastat tamevam vidvan so amutattvam atimurtimeti. That is in the Svetasudarupanayate. So tamevam vidvan atimurtimeti. Knowing that atma mrityamatyeti, one crosses over the death. And so, tamevam atmanamo vidvan, only by knowing the atma that one can cross the death and not by any other means. Nanyas pantraha vidyate ayanaya. For ayanam meaning moksha, other path, it does not exist. So all of these statements are there which show that knowledge is the only means of moksha and karma is not the means of moksha. So mana abhava is there and mana virudha also is there. Then says Vartika, na karmana kaniyasta vriddhirva nantaratmanah nityosya mahimetyavam udarkevi pravakshade. Then the Tika says, pratyak bhute mokshe karmanah atishe anadhayakatvacca tadasadhyaya iti aha na karmana iti. So pratyak bhute mokshe karmanah atishe anadhayakatvacca. Moksha is pratyak bhutaha. Is my very self. And the self is not available for any kind of an operation by karma. Meaning karma cannot do anything to self. And therefore karma cannot do anything to moksha, because moksha is of the nature of self. Pratyak bhutaha, moksha. Moksha is nothing but my own self. And this Shruti statement clearly says that self of the atma is that which is beyond the scope of any operation of karma. In what way? Na karmana kaniyasta. So, esha nityo mahima brahmanasya na vartate karmana no kaniyam. It will say later on. Esha nityo mahima brahmanasya. This is the brahmanasya nityo mahima. This is the eternal glory of Brahma. Brahma means brahmanam, meaning the self. Na karmana vartate no kaniyam. That glory can neither be increased by karma, enhanced by karma, nor can it be affected by karma. So glory of the self is such that it is beyond the effect of karma. And that self itself is moksha. That shows that moksha also is beyond the effect of karma. Nityosya mahimaya devam udarke vi pravakshade. Udarke means later on. It will be said in this text itself. Nityaha mahimaya. That is it. Esha nityo mahima brahmanasya na karmana vardate no kaniyan. That mantra also says, pratyak bhute mokshe karmana atishe anadhayakatvad. Karma cannot do any atishe. Karma cannot create any influence upon the self. Neither can karma enhance the glory of the self, nor can karma in any way affect the glory of the self. That means case, karma has no effect upon the self, and therefore karma has no effect with reference to moksha, which is the nature of self. Then says, shayi karma ajito lokah, nityo jnajitastu yah. It is pashtam shruteirvakyam, kasman nadriyadetvaya. Chai karmajito lokah. So atascha nitya sana sadhyayati. Even that mukti, for this reason also, mukti is not that which can be sadhya attained. Why? Chai karmajito lokah. Yathaya karmachito lokah kshiyate iti. So it's very clear. Chandogya Upanishad says that karmachito lokah kshiyate. The loka or anything that is attained as a result of karma is perishable. Anything that is attained as a result of karma or any effort is going to be perishable. So, kshayi karma. And so, therefore moksha that is a result of jnanam is not sadhya. As it was said earlier, jnanam merely reveals what is there. Jnanam does not accomplish anything. And so jnanam reveals the freedom which is already the nature of the self, and that's not that the freedom is accomplished, the freedom which is already the nature of self alone is revealed. And therefore, nityo jnanjirasvyah. It is pashtam shruter vakyam, the shruti very clearly says that. Katham nadve detvaya. Adara, why don't you respect that vakya? When shruti very clearly says that yathaya karmachito lokahakshyate, evameva mutra punyachito lokahakshyate. Shruti says that, even the swarga, which is the product of punya, also is perishable. Just as all the local lands here, which are attained by the karma, are perishable, so the swarga attained as a punya also is perishable, and also the result of jnanam is then this revelation of what is there, or manifestation of what is there, and therefore, jnanam, what is gained by knowledge, is not sadhya. It's something which is already there, therefore it is nitya. And so, katham nadri detvaya. How come you do not respect it? How do you do? Why don't you take that into account and give up your insistence that karma can be a means of moksha? The kind of moksha that we are talking about. The kind of moksha that we are talking about is mainly removal of ignorance and also manifestation of what is already there. So moksha is eternal, then alone it can be called moksha. If moksha also is perishable, then it's not moksha. Because again you are back to the bondage. So moksha or liberation must be there where there is no further bondage at all. So attainment of which, yat gatva nani vartante, attaining which there is no further bondage. That is the kind of moksha that we are talking about, and that moksha cannot be attained by karma. That's the point here. That people define moksha in different ways, and therefore they prescribe different means, which is all right. A given end can be attained by a given means, but moksha is not an end. And is something away from me, which it is not so. Then says the Vartika again, samuchyascha pisakrit puraiva smirakritah bhuyopiha pravakshyamah prasangannati vistarat. Again, so keval karmanah mokshahitutvam nirasya. So keval karma, that mere karma, one, many, in all, perform one, several times, lifetime, with dakshina, one cow, many cows, all the cows, etc., none of them, it has been established or shown here, how that karma alone cannot be the means of moksha. Keval karmanah mokshetutum nirasya, teshante jnana sanyogah. So, jnana sanyogah. Iti yatra uktam, tredha samuchyam nirasya, nirasya di. Then, sanyuga along with them. So, tesha means karma, jnana sanyuga, jnana samuchya. Where karma and jnana are pradhanam, equally pradhanam, or karma pradhanam, jnana is gaunam, karma gaunam, jnana pradhanam. These are three alternatives are there. When you want to combine two things, either you combine them equally. Or one is more, other is less. Or one is less, other is more. So, karma is predominant, jnana is subsidiary. And then, jnanam predominant, etc. So this tridha samuchya nirasati. Now the Vartikara takes that samuchya. So samuchyascha api asakat purahi sunirakratah. So pura na purayeva sunarakrata, purayevi sambandhopihi. Pura means earlier, meaning sambandha granthe, meaning when we in fact started the very introduction of this text. That itself, suran sumirakrata, very well we have actually refuted the idea of jnana karma samuchaya being means of moksha. That idea has been very well refuted right in the introduction of this text. But that people may have forgotten, you know. So many years ago that was. And therefore, samuchyasyavi asakrut purayeva sunarakrata bhuyobiha pravakshyama. Even though it has been very well refuted, bhuyobi. Still again, we shall state. Prasangat. Because prasanga is there. Because karma, jnana and samuchya is there, so occasion is there, therefore, again we'll refute that. Nati vistarat. So don't worry, we will not take too long, you know, nati vistarat. So, not in great detail, but in brief, we shall refute again the paksha of jnana, karma, samuchya. Why did it say, uttaratravi pasprasangatan nirakaram vakshyama? If the occasion comes later, then also we'll tell, you know. So, here the occasion is, as we are saying, and later on the occasion comes, uttaratravi prasangatan nirakaram vakshyamaha. So, idea is, so if prasanga comes, it always, it's not called repetition. It's always a reminder. And so, it is always good to remind, you know, of something that is important. And so, you keep reminding them, that is called abhyasam. And that is to emphasize the point, and not to bother or bore people, but to emphasize the point. And so, therefore, when an occasion comes, that nirakaranam is done. Or assertion is done. That jnana vinyasa moksha, you know, they will keep on asserting it again and again. Or karma or jnana karma samuchaya cannot mean some moksha, that also will be ascertained again and again. So, page 743, the first line says, tika ihavi na tivistaratan nirakaranam. Here also, the nirakaran of refutation of the jnana karma samuchaya being means of moksha will not be in detail. Sankshepastu brumahati yojana. But however, we shall state that in brief. It says, sannipatyena cha jnanam karma jnanam nirasyati sadhya sadhana bhavatvat eka kala anavasthitehe. Attravi samuchyam nirasyamaha na ativistaradi uktameva darshan. So again, same thing, that it is samuchya, and briefly we are going to refute that idea. Pramanajnyasya karmascha angangitvena samuchyam nirasyadi sannipatyedi. Pramanajnyasya karmascha angangitvena samuchyam nirasyadi. Samuchya means combination can take place in different ways. One kind of combination can be anga and angi. So, jnanam can be anga, karma can be angi, or karma can be anga, jnana angi. In this sense, as you said, that whole Satyanarayana puja is performed. You know? And then this Ganesha puja, Varana puja are called anga. Satyanarayana puja is angi, others are anga. So, that kind of a combination of samuchya is possible. If you can establish that jnana and karma enjoy this angangi bhava, that one becomes anga of the other, then of course you can, the samuchya can be established. But we say that the angangi bhava itself does not obtain, and therefore samuchya between jnana and karma is not possible. Sannipatya nacha jnanam. Sannipatya means what? Samipe sthitva. That's sannipatya. Yatha jnana sadhana vrihyadehe prokshan avaghatade. Just another footnote here, for example, vrihi. And so, this for example, so rice, you know, so rice paddy. And for that avaghata, in order for using that rice, avaghata, you must clean it up, you know, and so avaghatam, that pounding is required. And so, just this pounding is anga. So what you're offering in the homa or in the fire is the rice. But only that samskrutam, that which is clean and purified, etc. So first pounding is done, removing all the chaff, etc. And then proksham is done. That is for sanctifying. And then only the rice can be offered. And now, Or you can cook that also. Sometimes when it is further cooked, and then it is offered. Uncooked rice may not be, will not be offered, but cooked rice. So all of these are called anga. All of them go together. That samuchaya, the combination is required. This is angangi bhava. This is called sannipata. Sannipata means staying together. So, sannipatyana cha jnanam karma ajnanam nirasyate. All right, then can karma become a anga of jnanam? So, jnanam sannipatya, meaning staying together with jnanam. Just as at prokshanam or avaghada, etc., they stay sannipata along with the vrihi or the rice. So, that means that the anga of this rice, can similarly karma become the anga of jnanam? Since karma cannot dispel the ignorance by being anga or anga of jnanam. Why? Sadhya sadhana bhavatvat. See, anga angi are those which are always performed together. In one prayoga. Together means in one prayoga. One satyanarayan puja or whatever, all of these are there. But here karma and jnana enjoy what we call sadhya sadhana bhava. Karma is sadhanam and jnana is sadhyam. So karma comes first and jnana comes later. In that sense, they are not in one prayoga or they are not in one time. That being the case, therefore, karma cannot be means of dispelling ignorance by becoming an anga of jnana. Ekakala anavasthitehe. Therefore, they cannot actually be implemented or they cannot be practiced at one time because sadhya is first and sadhana is later. When the sadhya comes, the sadhana is no more required. Like when we are travelling by train from going to Bombay, then as long as we are in the train, so long we are not in Bombay. And when we are in Bombay, we are not in train also. So when the sadhya comes, the sadhana has done its job. So sadhya sadhana, so being in Bombay also and being in train, both of them cannot be. So ekakala anavasthitehe. The sadhana and sadhya cannot remain in one time. When one is, the other cannot be. Therefore, samuchaya is not possible. The idea is that samuchaya of the sadhana sadhya is not possible because when sadhanam is there, sadhya is not there. When sadhya is there, sadhanam is not there. And here, karma is sadhanam. How? The Tikakar explains. Karmanaha angatvena sannipatya jnanam na vidyam nirasyati tata hetumaha. Or either way also. Jnanam cannot become anga of karma. Karma cannot become anga of jnana because shuddhi dvara karma sadhanam jnanam sadhyam. Karma is shuddhi dvara. Bringing about antahakana shuddhi. Therefore, it becomes sadhanam. And jnanam, which is the result of that, is sadhyam. Tathacha purvottara kalayoho ekakala avasthitehe. So one in purva, other is later. So karma is purva, jnana is uttara. One is earlier, other is later. Therefore, ekakala asthitehe anavasthitehe. They cannot obtain it one time. Therefore, na angangitvam. Therefore, they cannot enjoy the relationship of anga and angi. Because anga angi are, like these hands are anga. The body is angi. They should be in one place at one time. Then alone they can enjoy angangi. If hand is there and the body is elsewhere, then they don't enjoy angangi sambandha, you know. Ek prayoga also must be there, or at one time also they must be there. So, na angangitvam. Na cha tat sadhyasya tadangatvam. So why not? Angangitvam, why can't you say? Why can't we say that the sadhya is anga of sadhanam, or sadhana is anga of sadhya? Na cha tat sadhyasya tadangatvam. Tat sadhyasya karma sadhyasya. Tadangatvam karmangatvam. So if you say jnanam is karma sadhyam, meaning jnanam is that which is achieved as a result of karma, why cannot jnanam, which is a result of karma, can become an anga of karma, a part of karma? Says eka prayoga anarudhatva. Eka prayoga. So even though eka kala may not be there, in Satyanayan puja, now you do the Varana puja, then you do Ganesh puja, then you do other puja. So one may say that one time they are not performed. One prayoga is there. In fact, one prayoga is there. And therefore they can have angangi bhava. Even if eka kalatvam is not there, eka prayogatvam is there, then also angangi bhava can be there. But eka kalatvam cannot be there, eka prayogatvam also cannot be there. Eka prayoga anarudhatvat. So, sangam karma phalasadhanam iti sthiti. Idea is that only karma along with various sangha can become the phalasadhanam. Yadi karma manasa shuddhi dvarangam tada eka prayoga rudhatva bhavat bhinna kalatvena asambandhacha nami bhavah. So, they are at different times, therefore they are not related, and so they are not anga angi. Neither as one prayoga they are performed, nor at one time they are performed, and therefore they do not have this angangi bhava, meaning part and whole. That kind of a bhava is not there. Relation is not there. Eka prayoga anaruhatvad. Then, janmantariyasya vikarmanah jnanopayat vangikarachari bhava. Not only that, but even the karma performed in the past birth can become means of knowledge in this birth. I'm sure everybody is, you know, we start from where we start. Everybody started from scratch, you know. Everybody started from some place. That shows that everybody has come with some preparation already. And that preparation has been done in the previous birth. Janmantariya karma. So that janmantariya syabhi karmanaha. Even the karma that is performed in the past birth also can become a means of moksha. Now, of course, the ek kalatam is not there. And it's not that one karma is given rise to antahakana shuddhi. And Swamiji always gives the example of what? The seventh vadai or whatever, you know. So this fellow says, you pay me only when he goes to a restaurant and he wants to eat something. It's all right. Pay me when your hunger is appeased. This fellow keeps on ordering vada. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So in seventh vada, then he's really tripta. His hunger is appeased. Then he has to pay. So he pays for one vada, seventh vada. So seventh vada is a piece of anger. I'll pay you for one. So it's not seventh vada, but it's a vada, they said, not vada. So not seventh vada. But all the seven have done it, you know. At the seventh vada, then you know that hunger is appeased. But hunger was being appeased with every vada. And therefore, when we say that the karma is actually means of purification of mind, it's not one karma. That process has been going on from past birth, who knows several births. So, jarmantaryasyabhi karmanah jnanupayattva angikarat. And therefore, this karma and jnana do not take place at one time, nor they are part of one prayoga. Therefore, you cannot say that they enjoy angangi bhava, and therefore, their samuchya in that sense is also not possible. So, that is there. Then, vādhivādaka bhāvācha. So very beautiful points here, you know. Vādhivādaka bhāvācha. Panchāsyorana yavariva. Beautiful examples are also given. Ekadeśānavasthānāt na samuccetātayoho. They cannot be in one place also, in fact. That's what he says. Samapradhānataya samuccam pratyāha. So what happens is, either karma is pradhānam and jnānam is gaunam, or jnana is pradhanam, karma is ganam. In that case, they need not be in one place. One can be first, other can be later. But if both of them are equal, then both of them should be together. Samapradhanataya samuchyam pratyaha. If karma and jnana enjoy the same degree of importance, then both of them should be in the same place. They cannot be in the same place. Why? Bhadhyabhadaka bhavacha. Because when jnanam comes, then the karma is dispelled. Bhadhyabhadaka bhava. The fellows don't look at each other. You know, for example, it says, panchasya uranayo riva. Panchasya and urana. Panchasya simha. Urana mesha. Like the lion and lamb cannot be together. When lion comes, then lamb is taken care of, you know, and therefore, bhadhyabhadaka. Lamb is what? Bhadhya. And lion is what? Bhadhaka. Similarly, light and darkness. When the light comes, the darkness cannot be there. Because light is there, we dispense darkness. So similarly, panchasya aranayoho eva arano. So urana. Panchasya and urana, just as they cannot stay in one place, so also jnana and karma cannot stay in one place. The relationship is not adversarial relationship. Therefore, they cannot stay together. So here, bhadhya bhadhaka bhava is there. Otherwise, at least for the two things to work together, you know, jnana and karma to work together to bring about moksha, they should have compatibility. Some compatibility must be there. Here one comes, the other one goes away, you know. In that case, this samuchya is not possible. So, therefore, ekadesh anavasthanat ekasmin asana. No, that is okay. Ekadesh anavasthana, that's what the verse said. Ekadesh anavasthana means ekasmin ashraye saha asthite. They can be in one time, but not in one place. So that means this lion can be here and lamb can be a few miles away. That can be so, but they can be definitely not in one place anyway. So ekadesh anavasthana. So in one place they cannot be. Ekasmin ashraye saha asthite. One ashraya they cannot be. There is one person they cannot be. In short, one person can be doing karma, other can be pursuing knowledge. That can be so. In one ashraya, Brahma Vidya and karma cannot be in one. Karma here means karma performed with kartrutva buddhi. Understand? Karma doesn't just mean chesta. Karma here means kartrutva buddhi. Because we said purushatantram karma. So karma is that which involves purushatant, sankalpa or kartrutva. That kartrutva buddhi and brahma jnanam cannot stay in one place. That's the idea there. Then karma can be performed by the body, etc., which is okay. But then that kartrutva buddhi, that hankara, abhimanam, that I am doing it, that cannot be along with brahma vidya. In that sense, there is bhajyavataka bhava. So, ek sthana anavasthanat, ek desh anavasthanat, or ek kala. At one, they can be at one place also, but not at one time, you know, that is another thing. So, they can be at one time, but not in one place. One place, but not in one time. One place and one time. That is called bhajyavataka bhava. And so, in one person the karma jnana can be there. Now there is karma, then there is jnana. That can be there also, but not at one time. Or in different locations, karma can be there, jnana can be there, but not in one location. So, one location and one time for samapradhanam. So, samuchya or combination for them to work together and then produce moksha, both of them should be there at one place and one time. That samuchya is not possible. Because they enjoy what they call bhadhi bhadhika bhava. Of course, in English they enjoy, you know. They enjoy means they have, that's all. They don't enjoy that bhadhi bhadhika bhava, but they have. Then, next verse is, bhadhi bhadhika bhavena kaumasya samuchyatihi swashaktya napaharena dahyadahakayoriva. Then nanu jnana karmanoho sambandha asti nava. Okay. Question is, jnana karmanoho sambandha asti nava. Are jnana and karma related or not? Tell us. Adye samuchya siddhihi dvitiye bhadyabhadakatva asiddhihi. That is my thing there. Okay. So, jnana karmanoho sambandha asti nava. Okay. Are they related or not? Then, adye samuchya siddhihi. If jnana and karma are related, then samuchya is possible. Dvitiye bhadyabhadakatva asiddhihi. The problem is, if they are not related in any way, then even bhadyabhadaka sambandha also is not there. That is also a sambandha. Bhadyabhadaka, so different kind of sambandha are there, you know. So bhadyabhadaka also is sambandha, you know. So that way light and darkness also related. In what way they are related? Bhadyabhadaka. One dispels the other one, you know. So the point is, you have to tell us whether these two are related or jnana and karma are related or not. If they are related, then of course samuchya you have to accept. If they are not related, then even bhadyabhadaka bhava is also not, because that's also a relationship. So he's asking, are they related or not related, you know? So, nanu jnana karmanaha karmanoho sambandha asti nava. Adye samuchya siddhi, if the sambandha is there, then samuchya or combination is possible. Dvitiye bhadyabhadakatva asiddhi. And so, bhadyabhadakatvam ekadeshatvam pramapayati. When bhadyabhadaka bhava is there, then they are in one place actually. Then, because this panchasya and urana. So when the lamb and the lion, bhadyabhadaka bhava will be there, when they are in one place. So when lamb is there, lion comes, you know, or whatever. Or lion is sitting and lion happens to come along. That may not happen, of course, but the lamb is there and lion happens to come. then of course lamb cannot be there. So, the question here is that even the Bhaktivadaka Bhava also seems to indicate that it is possible for them to be in one place. Because if they cannot be in one place, then the Bhaktivadaka Bhava also not. If lamb is a few miles away and the lion is here, then Bhaktivadaka Bhava is also not there. So when you say that the Jnana Karma have Bhaktivadaka Bhava, that means in a way you seem to be conceding that they can be in one place. If they can be in one place, then why can't they be combined, you know? This is just a technical point. They may not be combined for different reasons, but here we are telling them that they cannot be combined because they cannot be in one place at one time. But your Bhaktivadaka Bhava seems to say that they can be in one place, then how do you insist that they cannot be combined? This is the point here. So the Granthakara says, Bhaktivadaka Bhavena kamum astu samuchyati. All right. If you like samuchya or combination of them, let it be as you like. Kamam astu. Bhaktivadaka Bhavena. We can say, if you insist that they are related, all right, fine, you say that they are related as Bhadhya and Bhadaka. So that which dispels and that which is dispelled. So that which is destroyed and the one that destroyed. So destroyed relationship they can have. There is also a relationship. So, kamam astu samuchyati. That way the samuchya or combination of them can be there, that one is destroyed, other is destroyer. That relationship can be there. So shakti anapaharena dahyadahaka yoho iva. So dahyadahaka, just as the fire and the firewood. They also enjoy their madhyamadhaka bhava. One is a destroyer, other is destroyed. That kind of a combination is possible. So fire is there, you can add. See, they are working together. They are working together. But why? One takes away the shakti of the other. So that way, without the fire, actually remains fire. And that is how the combination is possible. See here, jnana gata badhagatva shaktehe, karma gata badhyatva shaktehe chatyagena sa swashakti anapaharena. So, their nature remains what they are. Meaning, the mesha remains mesha and the lion remains lion. And similarly also, jnana gata badhagatva shaktehe. Suppose jnana and karma, by jnana we should mean brahma jnana, aham brahmasmi, and karma means aham karta asmi, these two. So dehosmi is called karma, and brahmasmi is called jnanam. This is how we should understand. Aham brahma is jnanam, aham deha is karma. Because only that abhimana brings about karma. Brahmanoham, kshatriyoham, that will come. So that abhimana alone will be able to bring about a sense of duty on my part. So anyway, we'll discuss that. So, therefore, these are opposed, that's all. Dehoham and Brahmasmi, these two cannot be together. At one point and one time, when Brahmasmi comes, Dehosmi cannot be. If Dehosmi comes, Brahmasmi also goes away. This is what we call Viparita Jnanam, which has to be removed by Abhyasa. But once Brahmasmi, then Dhrata comes, then Dehoham, that kind of mati cannot be there. So, Jnanagada Bhadakatva Shaktehe. In Jnanam, there is Bhadakatva Shakti. Karma gada badhyatva shaktehe. In karma also there is shakti is what? Badhya, being dispelled. Atyagena, without giving up those shaktis of nature. Tayoho madhya badhakatvena sangatehe samuchyatihi. And therefore, that sangati meaning that kind of a sambandha can be there. So they are related as madhya badhaka. That kind of samuchya, if you like, have it as much as you want. Sa kasthagneho eva ishtahe vaityata. So that samuchyati we also want. That kind of a combination we also want. What? Bhadya bhajaka. Like dahya dahaka. So we also want that when jnanam comes, that karma is destroyed. Otherwise, if that relationship is not there, that is not good for us. So when jnanam comes, we want that the karma or ignorance will be dispelled. And so they do have bhadya bhajaka sambandha. And if that kind of relationship is acceptable, if you are satisfied, then that is called jnana karma samuchya, have it. If that kind of jnana karma samuchya, where one comes and the other is dispelled, if that kind of a samuchya is acceptable to you, have as much as you want, but that they can remain in the same place at the same time, in the same location rather, at the same time, that cannot be. अस्तु बाध्यवादक भावेन कामम अस्तु समुच्चिति ही सुशक्ति अनपहारेण मीनिंग ज्ञान इज दैट व्हाट यू ऑलरेडी सेड दाहि दहायतयोः इव ओके देन दिस नेक्स्ट वर्स इज अयथा वस्व विद्या स्यात् विद्यैतस्य विरोधिनी समुच्चयस्तयोरेवम् रवि रविशार्वरयोरिव उक्तम समुच्चयम् सोपवत्तिकम् उदाहरणान्तरेण दर्शयत् अगेन द सेम समुच्चय सोपवत्तिकम् अलोंग द रीजनिंग उदाहरणान्तरेण विधान द उदाहरणम् दर्शयति इति वार्तिकार शोस् अयथा वस्तु अविद्या स्यात् विद्या एतस्याः विरोधिनी अविद्या अयथा वस्तु अविद्या स्यात् अविद्या इज व्हाट अयथा वस्तु मीनिंग दैट वस्तु नोइंग इट डिफरेंटली सो वन इज व्हाट अग्रहणम अदर इज व्हाट अन्यथा ग्रहणम सो हियर अविद्या इज अन्यथा ग्रहणम टेकिंग द थिंग टू बी कॉन्ट्रेरी टू व्हाट इट इज विद्या एतस्याः विरोधिनी एंड द विद्या और द नॉलेज इज दैट which is opposed to ignorance, such as that. Samuchaya tayo evam, and therefore, that samuchaya is how? Ravi sharvaryoho eva, sun and the darkness. So just as the samuchaya of the sun and darkness is there, similar samuchaya can be there between jnana, vidya and avidya. The idea is that karma is a product of avidya, so by karma we should understand avidya. By karma we should not understand just any movement or activity. By karma we should understand avidya. But they use word karma because karma always involves kartrutvam. So where kartrutvam is there, avidya is there. And that is ahankar vimurhatma, kartaham iti manyate. So ahankar vimurhatma. So where is atma or antahkarana is deluded by the ahankar. With you, so identification of upadhi, that's where the sense of kartrutvam comes. Next verse is, Vastvadhina bhaved vidya, kartradhina kriya tatha, same thing. Kartradi chatma mohottam, svato karakatatmana, samuchya bhave hetvantramaha. Another hetu is said here, Vastvadhina bhaved vidya, vidya always is dependent upon the nature of vastu. The knowledge is true to the nature of the thing. Vidya, Vastvadhina bhaved vidya, kartradhina kriya tatha. Similarly, the kriya is dependent upon the karta. Kriya cannot be unless a karta or the notion of kartrutvam is there. By then, kriya means deliberate action. Kartavyam. I must do this. That kartavyam is not possible unless that kartrutva abhimanam is there. That I am so and so, and that I am doing this, that always is required for kartavya. In fact, this is where the fight is, if you want to call it fight. This is not, karma is not a problem, kartavya is a problem. So what actually the Vedantins want to refute is the idea of kartavya. So their intention of promoting this jnana karma samuchaya or combination of karma with brahma vidya is that the kartavya should not be given up even after brahma vidya. This is what they insist. That even when one has gained the knowledge that I am brahma, still he must continue to do his kartavya, his duty he must perform. Because yava jivam agnihotram jihoya, one should perform agnihotra karma until one is alive. And therefore, whether you are brahma jnani or not, you are still a part of the universe, and therefore you are still a recipient of many benefits, and therefore you must necessarily give, you must fulfill your obligations. You are still obliged, and therefore the idea is that even after brahma jnanam also sense of obligation remains. Vedantins say that by brahma jnanam, sense of obligation also goes away. That's all. So what does brahma jnanam do? They have no idea. They say that even if I know myself as Brahman, so what? Swami would say, so you are telling me something that I already am, that I have a pancreas. I did not know it so far, and now that I know that I have a pancreas, so what? Pancreas still remains what it is. If I have diabetes, that still remains. By knowing that I have a pancreas, no change happens. And so also, and therefore my diabetes does not go, I must still take medication or do what is required to cure or to take care of that. Similarly also I know I am Brahman. All right. So what? So I remain miserable anyway, and therefore I still require happiness, and therefore I must do what I have to do. And therefore karma is required. So they say that merely by knowing what is already there, nothing is achieved. Something can be achieved only by doing, and knowing nothing can be achieved. At the most, knowledge will be helpful, is helpful, so that you can perform karma. Knowledge of things that are existing is just academic. That there is sun and there is moon and there is this and that's there, all right, fine. You may know it for your pastime, etc., but it does not do anything to your life. In the life there are all these problems, they cannot be solved by this kind of knowledge. Similarly, I am Brahma, all right, so you know that. What happened? Nothing. And still, you have a mother-in-law, if I quote Swami's words, you know, and things like that. Therefore, those questions still remain. Or a daughter-in-law, whatever the case may be. And so, those things still remain. And therefore, so, Brahma-jnanam according to them is still, Brahma-jnanam also requires you to do what you have to do. And you cannot shirk your responsibility and take sannyasa. They do not accept sannyasa. Mimamsakas, strict Mimamsakas would not accept sannyasa, except apat sannyasa or something like that. They won't accept it. Because you can't drop out. This is a dropout. You cannot be a dropout, you know. And so you must do what is to be done. So these fellows are all called dropouts, according to them. And so such an amount of struggle is going on. It is an ideological struggle. Whether to perform karma or not is different, but ideological struggle. So ideologically, they cannot accept a situation where one gives you one's kartavya. And so, that's the thing. Here we are saying that there is a bondage. In fact, that's how we define the bondage. Kartavya sense, kartavya. I have to do something, it's a bondage. But why? Because without doing thing, I cannot be happy. Or I cannot be secure. So, if I don't do something, I have to lose something. If I do something, then only I can gain something. That is called bondage, because you are dependent upon something. Therefore, even if after moksha the kartavya remains, that I must do something, otherwise I will incur this sin, and better do something, otherwise I will be deprived of something else. So the sense of deprivation still continues, or a sense of helplessness still continues, what kind of moksha is that? A person who is liberated may do any number of things, not that he will not do. But it's not that he's obliged to do. Sense of obligation is a symptom of bondage, that's all. That I must do this, that is bondage. I may as well do millions of things, but not because you tell me to, then I will not do. No? There are some people who say, if you say I should do, I will not do it. Leave it to me, then I'll do. In home also it happens very often. So don't ask me to do what I should do, I'll do what I have to do. And if you say that do this, then I definitely will not do it, you know. So everybody resists that. And there is a reason behind it. I don't want to feel being obliged or being compelled. Nobody wants to be compelled. Because being compelled, either from outside or inside, is bondage. So either somebody is compelling me to do something, then also I feel helpless or I feel bound. Or something within me compels me to do something, that is equally a bondage. So this freedom of moksha means freedom from compulsion. And they believe that, no, that is not good. If the compulsion is gone, the fellow will become what? They'll be licensed. He will have license to do anything. So they think that swachandata or nirbandhata will come. Therefore, they feel that shasanam, shasanat shastram, that person and a human being must necessarily accept the shasanam or the ruling of the scriptures. Until means what? As long as you are alive, you must until then accept the shasanam or the rulership of the scriptures. Otherwise, you will become prey to your natural instincts, and that means what? You will be doomed. So that will be patanam. You will be deviated or you will fall down from a status. So they feel that if I do not accept the shasanam of the Veda, of the scriptures, then I will accept somebody's shasanam. Akarane pratyavayam. If you fail to do what you have to do, then you will incur sin, because when you don't do what you have to do, you will wind up doing something that you don't have to do. So, therefore a person will ultimately wind up doing things that are unbecoming of him, and that is how he will fall from his position. Therefore, the idea is that Veda is called shastra. Shasanat shastram. That which rules is called shastra. You say, Shamsanat Shastram, that which teaches is Shastra. Means that which rules is Shastra. So Vidhi and Nishedha. Vidhi is what? Do this. Nishedha, don't do this. Therefore, according to them, the Mahavakya of the Vedas is what? Vidhi and Nishedha. The Shasanam. Do this and don't do this. And that is how the scriptures actually guide you on your path. We say, no, scriptures never ask us to do something and don't ask us not to do some, ask us not to do something. Scriptures always tell us what is desirable and what is desirable. Because even if they say don't do that, I may as well do it. Just because somebody says don't do it, that words will not, are not enough to prevent me from doing something. Ultimately, it is my own will by which I do something or don't do something. If those words are able to influence my will, then it's fine. So, we say that even the Vidya and Nishedha are also meant for what? Only for giving me the knowledge of Ishta Sadhanam or Anishta Sadhanam, nothing else. And so Vedas, even though they appear to enjoin, they appear to command me, do this and don't do this, nobody ultimately commands me, it is my own nature which commands me. And if the scriptures are actually reaching that part of my personality is able to enable me to see that what I think is right is not right. And thus, if my own understanding changes, then what I do also will change. In short, what a person does is always determined by what the person wants to do. And what one wants to do is determined by what one considers desirable to do and undesirable. So everybody wants to do that which is desirable and wants to avoid undesirable. That is certain. People will do what is desirable and avoid what is undesirable. Except that my ideas of what is desirable and undesirable may be all confused. And therefore I may wind up doing things that are undesirable, thinking that they are desirable. And I may fail to do something that is desirable, not knowing that they are desirable. That is what the scriptures say. When they say do this and don't do this, they in fact are telling us or advising us or informing us of what is desirable and what is undesirable. Ultimately, it is left to me. Everybody knows Satyam Vada Dharmam Cha. If those vakyas are adequate to command this person, nobody would speak and tell a lie. But people do it anyway, because they think that telling a lie is desirable at a given point in time, therefore they do that. And so, the ideological thing is, should I accept the command of the scriptures, or should I accept the command of my understanding? We say that the command of the understanding is always there. And scriptures don't command, scriptures always inform us. Scriptures always give us a knowledge and not command. And when the knowledge comes that I am Brahman, then the idea of the duty or even idea of being commanded no more remains, because the person becomes spontaneous. Moksha means being spontaneous. And bondage means being impulsive. Being commanded or compelled by one's impulse is called bandhanam. And being spontaneous is called moksha. There is a stage in between, which is what we call a seeker, that is when one is deliberate. So therefore, yes, sadhaka or seeker is the one who is deliberate. Deliberately does what is proper to do, and deliberately avoids what should not be done. So that the samskaras, or the tendency to do the undesirable, those tendencies are overcome. And we deliberately create tendencies of doing something that is desirable. So ultimately, what is desirable becomes spontaneous. By practice, it becomes ultimately my habit, becomes one with me. And therefore the Vedantins will say that the kartavya buddhi, or that I must do something, that compulsion also does not remain. Even that bondage also is not there for the one who is mukta. Why is it so? Does it mean that he will become licentious? Does it mean that he will do just anything that he likes? No, because he does not require that command. He will automatically do what is desirable. He need not be worried, need not be afraid that he will violate. He won't violate. In fact, he will spontaneously do that which is good. So what we are saying is that a stage comes when even that deliberation is not required. They say that a person must always be deliberate. We say no. Even the deliberation also will give rise to spontaneity. When no deliberation is required, therefore no command or no instruction is required, person spontaneously does what is right. That is called moksha with reference to karma. So karma is something deliberate, moksha is that which is spontaneous. where spontaneity is there, deliberation is not there. In that sense, we say that jnana karma samuchaya is not possible, is not required. Karma has already done what was to be done. Karma means deliberation. That's what we call karma. By karma, we should understand dharma, meaning being deliberately good. And one has to be deliberate in being good when the deliberation is required. For one has become good. So we are saying that person is basically good. That's what Vedantin is saying. That person is basically good, therefore he can be spontaneously good. And therefore, when you find that a person is not good, that is not natural. When you say moksha is natural, meaning that person is basically good. And if you find him doing things that are undesirable, that is not natural, that is unnatural. And therefore, that unnatural thing can go away. So Vedanta, in fact, places a tremendous faith, you know, upon the person and upon the truth, that that is the ultimate truth, satyam. And therefore, everybody is satya, everybody is truthful, everybody is spontaneously good. That is a trust in the ultimate goodness of everything. This is what we want to invoke. We don't want to take it for granted the person is bad, even though he appears to be, even though the sandalwood appears to be stinking, it is not stinking, it is fragrant. And similarly also, even though a person appears to be a sinner, whatever he is not so. He is inherently good. And the goodness is the nature. And we can become that natural self. And that is what we call moksha. Moksha is the living life properly. That's all Vedanta talks about. What will happen after this death, etc. is okay. If you are good here, nobody is going to make you bad. If you are pure, nothing is there in the world that will make you impure. And so, how to live good life here? Being spontaneously good. That's all. And it can be so good that no deliberation also is required. You can be so good, you can be so pure, so loving, so free, that...